thanks for coming. As you know, this is Postfascismus in Europe, Postfascism in Europe, roundtable discussion with Veslav Miklós Tamás and our three other guests, which are Jaroslav Fiala, Michal Hauser, and Lubash Matoška. We'll get to all of them in just a moment, but first I want to thank the Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung for financially supporting the event, and to remind everyone, the event is sponsored by SERP, the SOP Združení pro levicovou teorii, Association for Left Theory, and I'll make this list of books that SOAP has published. I'll have it circulate. SOAP has published Jacques Rancière, Alain Badiou, and a number of other authors in Czech translation. And also, please sign the attendance sheet, which should be somewhere in the back. Prosím vás, nezapomeňte, je to tady předu, tak nezapomínejte podepisovat prezenčku. So now let me get back to the introduction that I promised a moment ago. Gáspár Tamás has just, well, we've published a new book for him, Czech translations of his important philosophical essays on the history of the socialist movements, state capitalist regimes, and the general social situation in Central and Eastern Europe before 1989-1991, and also on the transition, what came after, and how to understand the tortured relationship between the historic socialist movement and the communist ideal and the communist movement to which radical philosophy can aspire. So that's the new book, that's the background and our excuse for inviting Gáspár to visit us today. But that book doesn't include a couple of Tamás's best-known essays. There are a couple of seats up here in front, so please come. And one of those essays is his essay on post-fascism. He's also published on similar topics, nationalism, ethnicism, and a whole range of theory that he's developed that we provided a kind of the social and political and philosophical background to in this book. But we now, today, is our chance to discuss with him the meaning of this term, post-fascism, which is, this is, I think, a very original and important concept that Tamás has provided us with in the attempt that's now become very urgent to understand what is this phenomenon that we variously know as the extreme right, the new right, neo-fascism, or in its more euphemistic version, illiberal democracy. So this is the term that Tamás has proposed, post-fascism, for understanding this phenomenon within a broad constellation of social forces that are around it. And then we've invited Jaroslav, who's a political scientist, political theorist, and publisher, publicist, Michal Hauser, philosopher, and Lukáš Matoška, publicist, and also a radio employee. we're all going to, taking off from this central concept, discuss what it means today and what we should do about it. So yeah, I think we can start then with Gáspár explaining the term to both to those who already know it and to those who don't know what it means yet. Thanks.
Okay. I rather snap, actually, if I may, just to see you. And thank you for having me. And Bowers, I'm very happy to be here, but I'd book has been published. It's a great event for me. So it's a nice evening, but let's don't forget that the evening may be nice for us, but it's not so nice for those people. And I won't lose too many words about explaining my old essay that has been published 16 years ago in Boston Review. And I'll say a few words about this because that's the topic, and then I'll try to develop it further and to give it a term that might be probably topical or apposite to what the hell is happening these days that preoccupies all of us. The original concept of post-fascism, as it has been developed in quieter times than these, was the recognition that some of the features of historic fascism can be developed without any kind of totalitarian dictatorship, without any total destruction of the political superstructure and of a seeming respect for this and that and the other, most especially, of course, for the market. And still, some of the substantial aims of historical fascist movements can be attained through so-called democratic ways, i.e. through parliamentary procedures and such. But to realize this, you had to understand what was at the foundation of both historical fascism, as we knew it, well, thank God, most of us, not from personal experience, historically, and its contemporary versions. And apart from myriad other factors, I think that the essential term there, the core, was the end of what was called at one time republicanism, which means political equality, which was developed during the Enlightenment as an idea in which human rights and political rights had been approximated, in which political rights have been attributed, at least theoretically, to all humans, the condition of a citizen, the civic condition, in principle, pertains to all, and it is the duty of particular polities to make that presupposition work. In other words, in the classical parlance, to offer and to protect and to ensure rights to people. When there is a theoretical and even constitutional limit to what citizenship is, when there are categories of people who aspire in vain to the title of citizen, that means the end of the Enlightenment project and the beginning of fascism. Now, a number of states, a number of polities, a number of political arrangements in this world that were aiming at limiting civic rights to some categories of people. Also, there have been people who have been prevented from forming their own states and thereby to acquire civic rights and citizenship and so on and so forth. And another method, of course, has been to limit citizenship to an extent by curtailing participation, by creating political inequality of various forms, that has created a post-Enlightenment non-free society with the extraneous accoutrements of constitutional democracy, rule of law, seemingly intact. Obviously, you know, the usual techniques of racism, sexism, class oppression, war against various minority groups in various parts of the world, have been various forms of this, but it has been a very important change in people's thinking about these matters, and in powerful people's thinking about these matters, and in public opinion too, namely that the separation of citizenship and of the human condition have become operative again, that it has been recognized that citizenship is a privilege. After all, freedom of any kind in bourgeois society is a privilege anyway, but citizenship as a principle to be limited into some categories is a particular trait of fascist regimes. And there have been, of course, instances, I don't need to make a list of them, that exemplify this. And it has been a moment at the beginning of this millennium when many people, such as myself too, have to realize that the compromise of 1989 won't keep. That the development of recognition of rights and of civic condition has been forced by two factors. One was the defeat of Nazism and Fascism in 1945. And then, of course, the mutual deterrence and the equilibrium between the two world systems, called those of the Cold War, which turned out to have been the Cold Peace. There's no war came about, thank God. That has forced both systems to build a number of social institutions, various social institutions, of course, there are differences from place to place, that preserve a modicum of dignity even for subaltern classes, and to associate social rights, various welfare arrangements, various social methods of preserving dignity. That was sort of an equilibrium of the welfare state, both in the liberal capitalist and this post-Stalinist, post-56 versions in the Soviet bloc. But after 89, there was no extraneous force to keep capitalism bound to its self-limitations and of its respect of the adversary, which is of course the proletariat. One, the extraneous threat of the Soviet bloc doesn't exist anymore. Secondly, an old thing that we sometimes forget to mention when we speak of such matters, the fact that the workers' movement have been defeated by fascism in the 20s and 30s is a permanent fact. The workers' movement has never really recovered. All the revolutionary initiatives after the Second World War came from outside the organized workers' movement, including 68, where partly still the traditional working class in France has played an important role. It was an arrière-garde fight in that respect. But it was called the Third World, the student movements, feminist movements, peace movements, etc., etc., etc. And the only workers' movement that has been victorious, Solidarność, has departed in many respects from the tradition of the workers' movement. In some respect, not, actually. But the workers' movement is an independent and autonomous force that could limit the majesty and the unlimited power and glory of capitalism. Doesn't exist anymore. And although, of course, some amendments and some sequels exist, and it's not a totally finished story, as we know, nevertheless, the constraints that capitalism has suffered from various places, it's not there. Also, capitalism was limited by the past. In the first half of the 20th century, dynasties great churches, great landowners, London state aristocracy, still played a role. Europe was still a continent with huge peasant populations. The pre-capitalist past also played a limiting and moderating role. There was a conservatism, but you know, the alliance of throne and altar, that was of course decadent and disappearing, but still it was there and it played a role and it has influenced many things. And both that has disappeared. So as it were, the moderating influences on the right have disappeared from the past, and also the moderating and limiting influences from the future, as it were, from the side of proletarian socialism. Okay. That's a very superficial sketch of what I said about this and since. But now I would like to add a few things that I haven't written about yet. There's one thing that you should really look at very carefully. The point at which fascist systems materialize, it's always at the limit of economy and politics, and it always was a strategy of capitalist societies to save themselves by giving up a lot of its traditional convictions, habits, techniques, and behaviors. What was most conspicuous and important politically in the long run, but fascist systems of various kinds, they were also varied, of course, was that the ruling class has relinquished part of its political power, has ceased it to relinquish it to a counter-revolutionary military or paramilitary apparat and a movement apparat, which of course exercised its power in harmony with the interests of the ruling class, but it wasn't the ruling class that was governing. You can't say that the great German capital has governed Germany under Hitler. The ruling class remained the ruling class, profits didn't disappear, and the market went on, although great scale state intervention was in place. Nevertheless, government was in the hands of a non-bourgeois, separate group of people whose main inspiration and main myth and idea was the war. These people were all coming from a veterans organization, and they all came from the First World War, and that was their only mainstay ideologically. They could understand their lives only in terms of struggle. And as such, they were the exact counterparts of communism, of proletarian communism. Because the communists too, after 1917, 18, 19, came from the trenches. They were also the victims both of the imperialist war and of the betrayal of social democracy. And they too knew that if they wanted to attain what they wanted, it was armed struggle that would get them the desired results. That was the lesson of the trenches. They learned the lesson of violence. And because always the interest, the main interest of capitalism was, of course, to defeat proletarian socialism, it was this group of counter-revolutionary cadre, mostly military people, and a few, quite a few paramilitary ones, but trained in war, who were the only ones capable of beating proletarian communism at its own game. The main aim of National Socialism especially, but also the Italian fascism and so on, was of course not what they said to their supporters, the fight against liberal capitalism, that was the ideology, well described by Herbert Marcuse, and the importance of the anti-liberal struggle in the Nationalsozialistische Staatsaufpassung, yeah, it sounds much better in German, state doctrine. And but it was, of course, the end of the communist struggle. The aim was to smash communism, and in that they succeeded. That was the struggle for capitalism, but not the fight of capitalism itself, and it was not already in the name of capitalism. It was in the name of the race, and it was the name of the struggle, and the name of a rebirth of a society that was a non-class society, not in the sense of being a classless society, but in the sense of a society based on something allegedly more profound, that is something outside society, namely nature, namely race, of course. Now, okay, so that was the element, you know, in which the proportions and the rapport de force between rulers and governors has changed. Of course, it has been seen like that the roots were there already, Bonapartism, as discovered already by Marx. How indeed could proletarian masses be mobilized against socialism in a military and nationalist manner? Everything has a precedent, everything has a past, so has fascism. And although it's a very modern and contemporary phenomenon. Now, when we don't have communist movements, large communist movements, and the dangers besetting capitalism are of a different nature, the solutions of post-fascists are more variegated. In some East European countries, for example, and in some Asian countries, it is indeed state groups that are taking over governing, also taking over some functions of the ruling class, not changing anything in the structure of capitalist society, but managing to mobilize also anti-capitalist energies. The most, you know, for me, the most obvious example, of course, is Hungary, where you have a government calling capitalism, as many people do, calling capitalism neoliberalism, which has the added advantage, apart from blaming capitalism, blaming economic doctrine for the ills of capitalism, and also it has the added advantage of appearing foreign. Neoliberals are by definition foreigners. And so the Orban government and its troops are not themselves bourgeois. They may have bought up forcibly enterprises for their own gain, but that's the corrupt element. That's not interesting. Interesting for the interested. But the fact is that it is not the bourgeoisie, it's not the capitalist class, it's not the foreign investors govern Hungary, but a group of people whose roots are in a political movement and an ideology that also is conceiving of itself as being extraneous and foreign to capitalism, the interests of which it serves very well and very humbly. You know, their politics are totally neoliberal, you know, flat tax, you know, end to unemployment benefit, etc., 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 etc. Forced labor for the unemployed, like in Slovakia too, you know, nowadays. And so that's one version. Such versions exist. And of course, there are sections of the old state apparatus, like in India, for example, allied religious forces on a governing India, also serving very well the interests of capitalism, but at the same time, of course, founding the system on caste. On caste and on race, and not on, you know, market liberty and what have you. And that seems to be just a superficial change, but it isn't. Because, of course, in any capitalist system, the main political problem is how to put people to work, to profitable work, that will serve capitalist accumulation. And if that is happening in the classical form of free labor and freedom of contract, that's the ideology of capitalism about itself, it's never purely so, but yeah. But if that changes fundamentally, If violence, coercion, state interference, regimentation play a role in putting people to work, well, that's a different system, and that has fascist characteristics. But you know, it's not everywhere like that. You know, that also now we are witnessing a very strange and possibly clumsy attempt, for the first in a very long time, for the ruling class to govern itself. That's the, if I'm not very much mistaken, about Mr. Trump's cabinet. The cabinet of billionaires, of entrepreneurs, except of course Mad Dog Mattis. But he's exceptional. Yeah. So all these rich amateurs are now really presumed to govern. That would be interesting. But that also shows that there's something wrong with the classical state machinery that has accompanied capitalism until now. But whatever the technical differences between these various regimes and attempts and experiments of new anti-liberal, anti-democratic, anti-social governance, one thing is common. Namely, that they have changed fundamentally one important aspect of classical historical fascism. Classical and historical fascism was unified in the ideology of elitism. They spoke of charismatic leadership and exercised charismatic leadership and were openly contemptuous of the masses. The masses that are, you know, about what Goebbels called the socialism of quantity, that was Jewish socialism, you know. National socialism, but of course the socialism of quality, an expression that played a very important role in Hungarian history of ideas. Quality socialism has been an idea, largely accepted cultural idea in the 1930s in Hungary, and few people know that it's directly from Hitler and Goebbels. Anyway, and so, you know, the Nazis were thinking of themselves as Wagnerian heroes in the midst of time, you know, fighting with the forces of the underworld, being, you know, gifted with this divine inspiration. This is all gone. Now we have almost the opposite. Now our post-fascists are supposed to represent the common man, the ordinary folk. We are like you, well, they're not, but we are like you. That's the idea. That now finally has come the time that those people representing not the interest, again, that's again very fascistic, not the interest, but the essence. That's always been the case of nationalism, racism, ethnicism, that is represented not the people's will, but the people's essence. And but still they have this democratic gloss of representing the common man against the strange, the elites, and so, you know, they always talk. And that's quite new. That's also because it's that's post-fascism. It has to give itself a sort of a plebiscitarian, pseudo-democratic justification. But at the same time, that's an important change. That's an important change. There are analogies. Even classical fascism, of course, has imagined its adversary as a conspiracy within the highest, identified, of course, with Jewish elites, and the lowest, i.e., the mostly unemployed and the very poor proletarians and sub-proletarians of the Communist Party. Don't forget that the German Communist Party, that's historically the most important warring partner of the Nazis, was a party of the unemployed, mostly. And so the explanation was, of course, that the obscure elite is using the poorest, the most desperate, that could be the best element of our people, but they're poisoned by their foreign demonic views and whatever. there's an element of this too. Of course, even today, where, you know, it's quite interesting that elites are called groups that, at least in principle and hypocritically, maybe, but they're still advocating in a timorous way some sort of equality. No, I mean, don't beat up the blacks. Don't shoot them. You know, refrain, if possible, from mass rape. It's kind of very, very, very timid, very mild, you know. That's, you know, people who would really refrain from the worst, especially if it's within their national borders and if it doesn't touch on occupied territories and the victims of their wars and such like. But even those people who, in a very, very moderate and limited way, are not in principle opposed to human equality, I consider to be elitist. And those who are for inequality are not. So to say that the idea of the common man and democratic way of thinking is in favor of inequality and discrimination, and that opposing, however timorously, discrimination and inequality is elitist, that's mind-boggling. Nevertheless, it's very successful for a variety of reasons that I don't go into. Everybody knows what they are, and even dimmest journalist is aware of them. They've been written up sufficiently and sufficiently well. Okay. So, but you see, these ideas, pro and con, of equality, of equal dignity, of participation, of leaders and led, of who has the political power and who are in the ruling class with or without political power, this was the problematic of the fascist era, and this is the problematic of our day too. Even if you are not directly threatened by concentration camps and gas chambers and whatnot, you're not, I think. Nevertheless, morally, politically, economically, and socially, the threats are considerable. And also, some of the threats are threats of violence and of physical coercion too. And, you know, huge masses of people are incarcerated. I mean, innocent people are incarcerated because of what they are. As you know, racial and ethnic and national and religious, denominational and gender and sexual lifestyle-based discrimination is rampant everywhere. And the well-known refugee situation, to which I have sacrificed most of my time in the last year, is a good example of what we are faced with. So this is not a theoretical question only any longer. And two more words, can I?
Two more, sure.
Okay. So, okay, just a few. But, you know, here, if you will allow me a little philosophical jargon. How is this succeeding? What fascism does successfully is to ontologize various kinds of human conditions. Because you see, capitalism is a system in which your social position is in principle more or less random. You are not necessarily born into the position of a proletarian or a petit bourgeois or intellectual or whatever. All these roles are distributed randomly by the work into the capitalist economy. And capitalism for a long time indeed tried to keep the legal and political and social possibilities open for this randomness called also freedom in an erroneous way in order to develop the capitalist economy. It was in their interest. But you see, that was the early capitalism, that is 17th, 18th century, at least ideologically. And what fascism does, and by this has changed the political and moral and ideological character of capitalism, maybe forever, is to combine the randomness, the aleatoriness of capitalist society, in which life's biographies are unpredictable, imprevisible, you don't know how you'll end up in this role or that, in which, you know, terms like choice have been until recently credible for naive people, and because groups to which people belong have been now redefined as natural groups. You belong to a race, you belong to a gender, you belong to a culture. That's today's great slogan, the culture, in which you are embedded to a way, in a way, according to the new ideology, that is not capable, nobody is capable of changing. What are we being told by subtle ideologists and by vulgar politicians alike? Because they don't think that the subtle columnists and propagandists are so much different from the Orbans and Zemans of this world. They are even worse than those. Although it's difficult to imagine how. Namely, that if people, for example, who grew up in an Islamic culture are bound to behave in X way, people, you know, grown up and really socialized in, you know, in a Western Christian bourgeois liberal society, will behave differently. The aim to keep our freedom is to keep these two things apart. That is, social groups are being renationalized. Belonging to a cultural group is ontological. And that is not only going back from before the Enlightenment, it's going back from before Aristotle. And it is a very, very serious business. And it is very largely believed. Frau Merkel, how we call her, Merkelova, Frau Merkelova just declared yesterday that she, the beacon of light in this darkness of Europe, if I'm not very much mistaken, will prohibit the complete veil, the burqa. Well, of course, in a more humane and democratic way than others. And this means that people like her, have no substantive objection to the ontologizing and naturalizing of human categories and belongings and so on and so forth, but only want to be kinder and milder and nicer about it than others. So that's a difference of degree and not of kind. This is a capitalism, my dear friends, which cannot be considered with the best will to have anything to do with the ideas of the French Revolution and the tradition of liberalism, let alone other things. And this is what humankind will have to fight, although it has less weapons than any of our predecessors. It is one of the most difficult tasks I can imagine. And people such as yourselves who will come together in such rooms many times of the world will have to think about things that we haven't thought for a long, long, long time. And meaning, what's to be done? Meaning, what about power? Power will be defeated only by power. We don't want to take power. The whole ethic of the new left has been our distaste for power. So that's a real problem. I don't know the solution to it, but I can see that it's a problem. We because indeed the urgency of the crisis is very, very sharp and very heavy. Sorry for having talked for so long.